Good afternoon, welcome back. My name is Kim Leong. I'm your track host or moderator for the kernel and platform track. So as usual, I begin by thanking the sponsors, Google, Microsoft, openSUSE, where Gary works for SUSE, and Oracle, MySQL, Daimler, and some of the other names, I'm not quite sure what they are. Okay. So the talk by Gary Lee, okay, who works for SUSE, is develop UEFI with openSUSE. In the BIOS time, firmware was usually obscure, and OS developers had to deal with it by experience. Nowadays, most of the firmware hardware vendors share the code from open source project EDK 2 in their own UEFI implementations, so it's easier to understand and how the firmware works, especially the hardware independent software stack. And EDK 2 contains sub-project OVMF to provide firmware for QEMU, the virtual machine, so we don't need bare metal to implement features or debug hardware independent issues anymore. Okay, no need to flash program, just copy the file to update the firmware immediately. The talk will present how to develop and debug OVMF with openSUSE and introduce new UEFI features in openSUSE Lib 42.2. So Gary Lee is a SUSE engineer based in Taiwan, long time Linux user, but participates in openSUSE GNOME development, or participated? Okay, and mainly focuses on UEFI related issues now. Okay.
Hey. Hello everyone, and I'm Gary Lin, and I work for SUSE. So, and I found the SUSE Taipei. And so I mainly work, as I, the moderator said, I mainly work on the UEFI stuff. So today I want to share with you my experience of developing UEFI with openSUSE. That's basically my daily life. And so our topic today is UEFI. So what's UEFI? And it's an acronym of the Unified Extensible Firmware Interface. So as it stands, that is a firmware interface between the firmware and the operating system. And there's an organization called the UEFI Forum, and they will make the UEFI spec for the firmware vendor, so they can follow the spec to implement their own firmware. And as an operating OS vendor, then we can just use the protocol defined by firmware to access the hardware resource. So it's more like a easier to unified way to access the recovery resource among the different firmware. So for OS vendor, it looks like, so in the beginning, the motherboard, you will know the UEFI from its fresh run, and the UEFI will start to load the bloater. Okay, and UEFI load the bloater, and the bloater will load the Linux kernel. And Linux kernel will start any other service, so you can like the desktop or server, whatever. So it looks like BIOS and sounds like BIOS and smells like BIOS, but it's kind of different. So the BIOS is there's an open source project called the EDK2, and it's actually hosted by Intel. So an EDK2 is actually a BSD license reference implementation. So every time there's a new UEFI spec, then they will add the new features into EDK2. So and nowadays the firmware vendor they would grab the code, just merge the code from EDK2 into their own firmware. So maybe the UI looks different, but actually some features may actually use the same code. And this is very good for us because we can just check the code in EDK2 and to know what really happened. Okay. Driver, it didn't include because the driver may be a proprietary driver or whatever, but basically most of the things are in EDK2 but not included driver. So likely your GPU driver or the network card driver, you will not have it. But then some maybe the BSP for the small server, the board.
So you need driver in the firmware also?
The BSP more like the first program for the for the motherboard, so you will need that to put into your own EDK2.
Okay, you need a driver to read the hard drive and also to do a network boot.
Hard drive maybe not, but mostly for the network driver and the GPU driver.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, and so for EDK2 and it's a open source project, so it's very good for us. We can just look into the code and know what happened. And it's also a C language based, not like the old BIOS days. It's I heard it's all from the assembly code, so maybe even an open source to you, and you may not really understand that. So, and it also uses a modularized design, so you don't have to build everything into your firmware. So you can decide which part of the feature you need and just enable it or disable it. And it also supports the multiple architectures, so it's quite good. And basically, on average, there will be one release every year. But as I say, it's an open source project, so actually, it's every day there will be a lot of patches be committed into the Git repo. So for me, I'm testing the UEFI stuff, and I would like to test the new feature as soon as possible. So I cannot wait for the firmware vendor to provide their own firmware to me, and this would be too slow because they will have their own QA process, and maybe after the UEFI spec, maybe after a year, they just provide their features, so they're too late for us. So I would need a kind of a development board, and the development board is a special board. You can just fresh the firmware and update very frequently and any version you need. So there are two kinds of solutions you can have. So first is a bare metal, just a physical machine. You can buy from like Intel or AMD, they have this kind of things. And the other advantage is it's very, very close to the production machine. So, and you can add the real network card, new GPU to the machine, so you can test it if you want. But the problem is it costs money, and also you need a space for the board. Especially buy from Intel, it's actually a workstation, so you need a space for that. And you cannot buy it every generation, so it's quite expensive. Not very expensive, but it's still money. Maybe $1,300. So you need ask for from your boss, and it also can be very slow to fresh to program the fresh ROM. And for example, like the middle board and the SPI hook, if you use this kind of solution, you took around 5 minutes, just a few megabytes write, and very slow. If you just want to add a debug message, and you have to wait 5 minutes, and this is not very efficient. So this is the solution I choose. I use a virtual machine, and because it's a zero cost, I don't have to ask my boss to buy anything for me. So it's much easier, and I And it's very, very fast to update the firmware because you just copy the file and that's it. So that's very easy. And you also can share your settings with your colleagues. And especially it's very useful for the QA because if you want to verify an issue or fix the like verify a bug, and the QA must know how the settings and how to set the firmware or whatever. And with a virtual machine, you can just tell him or she how to use the virtual machine and which setting you are using, and that's it. But there's a downside. If you need something very special, like a very special GPU, a very special network card, or like a TPN, TPN support is not very good now. And yeah, you may have some problem with the virtual machine, but for me, that's mostly I'm working on the software stack, kind of independent from the hardware stack, how hardware, so this is not a big issue for me, so mostly I use the virtual machine. So virtual machine, so what is my virtual machine solution? It's a QEMU plus OVMF. QEMU is a very standard virtual machine nowadays. Every Linux distro uses it. And OVMF is a and what's it, OVMF? So OVMF is the open virtual machine firmware. So as its name says, you can see it's a firmware for the virtual machine. And what's best is a EDK sub-project. So actually, it shares codes in the EDK too. So it means you also share the code among all those firmwares. So this is very good for me. I can just test some software stack bugs or some software stack features with EDK 2 and with OVMF, and I can make sure it all works on all those firmwares, and this is very good. Then okay, now we know OVMF, then how can we use it? Then first you have to build a firmware. Yeah. So it's very easy, just a few steps. So first you clone the source code from the Git. It's in the GitHub. So you can just check, you can just Google the EDK2 GitHub and you'll find it. And the next step, just run the build script in the OVMF PKG, and you can add the dash D and add some build options. And build options, you do have to check the README and the build script. And so, but I only did this today because I don't have much time for this. So, but if you are really interested, you can check into the README. And so, if everything goes well, yeah, the build script just works for me, it works for you, and you will get two firmware files. The first is the OVMF code, the other is OVMF VARS. OVMF code is a compiled machine code, and VARS is a very kind of special section for the UEFI. Because in UEFI, you need to store the non-volatile data in the fresh ROM. And so you need a section in the fresh ROM that is writable. And so this is how they... So the VARS is how the emulate the writable fresh ROM. So if you are using openSUSE, then you don't have to view it by yourself. If you just want to try that, you just need to zipper install OVMF, QEMU OVMF, -x86-64. And I already packed it for you, so if you really want to try that, and you can just download and install it. It's very easy, just one command. And then you will see those files in your systems. So I separate the code part and the VARS part because, as I say, the VARS is a kind of special section. It has to be writable. And you see that there are some kind of different flavors, like NS, SUSE, openSUSE, and it's for the secure boot. Because the secure boot, you have to enroll some key into the firmware. And NS is the firmware enrolled the Microsoft key, and the other is SUSE key, openSUSE key, so I can just put the firmware in the testing, but secure boot works for me. Okay, so after you install that, and now you can try to start your own virtual machine. So first you create the firmware, the variable store. The variable store has to be writable. So originally it's in a system directory, so you have to copy to somewhere you can write. And so you start a virtual machine and you can write it to the bus store. And the next thing is you can just create a virtual EFI system partition. This data is not really necessary, but I always use it because it's a very convenient for testing the UEFI application. You can just copy your UEFI application into the virtual EFI system partition, and the firmware can recognize it right away, so you don't have to create a disk image for the virtual machine to start your test. And the next is to start a QEMU. So this command looks quite complicated. But actually, just those two lines are really matters. So first, you have to specify the pfresh, the device for your code, the code firmware. So the OVM code part, and the other one. So you can see the code part has to be read only, yeah, because it's just code. So it's not supposed to be write into any data into it. Or you will break your firmware. So the other one is to specify your bus store, and you can see here there's no read-only parameters, so it's writable and readable. And this one, the last line is how I create the virtual EFI system partition. So I just specify the directory as a fat partition, so the firmware can just read the content. So if you do this right, then you will see this screen and the Tiana code logo shows, and you are done. And so you can start your work and to load your UEFI application. Okay, so now we have this virtual machine solution, and the next question is how can I debug it? And yeah, it is a very important question for me. Yeah, how to debug. So first, as a C programmer, you are very familiar with this, just print the debug message. So yeah, like you, maybe you do your your C programming and add some printf or whatever printf to print the error message and to try to identify which part is wrong. And yes, it's very the same as the OVMF, and we can add a debug message. So it's very easy to add debug message. There's a macro defined in EDK2, it's called debug. Yeah, very straightforward. And so if you are trying to use debug, and you have to specify a debug label. And then the format is much the same as the printf. So if you are C programmer, you are very familiar with. So then what is a debug label? It's more like it's actually a big mask for all the debug message. So it's defined in the OVMF PKG S64 DSC, this file. So it's actually hard code in the firmware, so you cannot change it after you build the firmware. So you have to specify the value in the very beginning. And by default, it's a 0x800004F. Then what is mix? And so I listed here. So it's more like you just order all the debug labels here. So it means you turn on the initialization arrow or initializing message and the warning message.
Yeah, I'm going to try again.
So yeah, it's a, as I said, it's a big ask for those values. So the previous thing, yeah, I used debug info. By default, you use the debug info here. So usually I use this. And actually, you can turn on all the debug messages if you like, but I would not recommend that. Yeah, you can turn on by assign the old, like the AXF old to this value, and but I would not recommend to turn everything on because it will cause your system very, very, very slow because it's always printing something and it's not very useful. But unless you are trying to debug some very difficult issues and you really need it. So then after you have the debug, after you add a debug message, then you can catch the debug message with a command, a special command from the QEMU. You can add a debug console. So by default, you can use add this command to the QEMU settings. And usually, I will redirect the error into the debug, like a debug.log, this kind of file. You can also redirect into the like a socket or some like a SDDI or whatever. But redirect to the file is most convenient way for me because I can check the error message later and to make sure what happened. So then after you start your virtual machine and with the debug console, and you can check the debug message with another console with a tail-f debug double. That's what I do, so I can catch the error message right away. So yeah, this is usually you can debug some with this kind of debug message, but sometimes you may have like a crash or a very serious problem, and so you will need another way to catch the crash because sometimes it's crashed and it's too fast, so the debug message cannot be printed, and so it happened before, so it's sometimes give me some very difficult time. So you will need another way to debug it, and another debug is source level debugging. So it's actually like you debug the OVMF with the GDB, and so if you know GDB, then you can debug with that. But it's not very easy to set up this because there's a source label debugging package building in the EDK2, but it never works for me, and it's quite, I don't know, I never heard anyone really successfully use it. So basically, I would suggest to download its external debug PKG from another GitHub and build it by yourself. So it's quite a complicated thing, and I list the reference here, so if you have I think this slide will be available, so if you are really interested in the details, you can check the link later. So but if you are using the openSUSE, then I already packaged the debug package for you, so you don't have to build all the things by yourself. It's very easy, just install the debug package, and yeah, that's it. But so after you have a debug package, then the next thing be kind of complicated, more complicated before from another than the debug message. Because you have a few steps to set up the. You need a few steps to set up the debug and source level debugging. So first, you have to start the QEMU with the dash s, or you can use the dash gdb and specify the TCP port 1234. Those two commands are actually equal, and so you get by default you can just specify the dash s, then it means you open the 1234 port for debugging, and then you have to specify your architecture. So I usually use the x64, so I usually specify the x64. So and then use the target remote is the GDB command to connect to the debug GDB server. And so in this case it's more like the QEMU open a GDB server for software inside the virtual machine. So you have to target remote the local host, because I do it in locally, so local host 1234 the host. Then after this command, you will connect to the GDB server, and you will see your virtual machine start here, because you is connected to the GDB server, and you stop the virtual machine, and for a while after you type continue, then you will start to do anything next. So after you connected to the virtual machine, then you have to include a special GDB script. It's a Python script, and the GDB can read it. So and next is to use the command reload the dash UEFI.o, and this is the debug symbol. So more, it actually is not a real debug symbol, but start for the debug symbol. So after you load the symbols, you start to load all to pass all the symbols in the firmware, so you can connect to and grab all the sources from the for the firmware. Then yeah, after this very complicated steps, then you can do it as you can debug your UEFI, your OVMF with GDB. So it's very useful, because you can attach GDB and reproduce your crash. And when the crash happens, you will just run into GDB, and you can use GDB to see the backtrace and do whatever you want. So you can check like a register or the variables, and yeah, very useful. Okay, summary. Then for me, I will recommend to, if you are you want to try the debugging the UEFI stuff, and I would recommend to use the virtual machine to as your zero cost developer, because it's free, and you can modify the firmware by yourself. It's very useful. And I would recommend that test a code with the GDB debug method, because you can just check a log file, and you will know how the firmware works. And if you have a crash happened, and try to attach to GDB and catch the crash. Yeah, that's basically my suggestion. So, questions? Any questions?
No questions? Okay, so round of applause for Gary.
Yeah.